A very good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Notebook Together for Education webinar. Today is the 30th edition of this webinar. About three and a half months back, the schools had just shut down because of the coronavirus pandemic. A lot of schools were facing issues with adopting these digital portals. And with the thought of making these portals more easily accessible, more easily usable, we at Notebook set up a series of webinars called Together for Education. Since then, every week we've had two webinars, and the people who have loved and supported us over these so many months have only grown in numbers. We have tackled topics ranging from academics to co-curriculars to holistic development to the level of spirituality and the power of why. Today, we have another very interesting topic that we want to discuss: beyond the boundary walls. In a normal school environment, a student spends some amount of his or her day inside the school campus, and then some amount of his or her day outside. And the school ensures that the education system can make the student behave, act in a certain way, even when they're outside those boundary walls. Today, when students are stuck at home, learning on their digital portals, it becomes so much more important that the schools exercise their influence on the students' lives, even when they're sitting at home and studying. We have a fantastic panel for you today, but before we move ahead with the panel, what I would do now is show you a small clip of one of the Notebook videos. We at Notebook use art, engaging music, and the power of storytelling to make academics more accessible, more enjoyable for every student out there.
The explorers came to understand the geographical regions of the Earth in terms of latitude and longitude from the Ptolemy's geography. The Europeans believed that the Earth was divided into three continents: Asia, Africa, and Europe. And they also underestimated the width of the oceans from Ptolemy's account. So they set out on their voyages to discover new lands courageously and spiritedly. The Arabs, Chinese, Indians, and the Vikings were among the first voyagers to cross the oceans from the Old World much before the Europeans. The Europeans, especially the Spanish and the Portuguese, crossed the oceans in search of new lands for economic, religious, and political reasons. The declining conditions of trade and commerce in European countries like Italy since the mid-14th century, diseases and wars, shortage of gold and silver for coins, and the conquest of the Constantinople by the Turks in 1453 urged Europeans to make new voyages and discoveries. Europeans also wished to spread the religion of Christianity through these voyages. Trade links with Asia had increased, and the Europeans were lured by products of Asia. They wished to establish colonies in the warmer Asian climates. Portugal had recently achieved independence from Spain, and they led the expedition to West Africa in search of gold, thanks to their developed fishing and sailing skills. Prince Henry of Portugal called the navigator the pioneer of this discovery, attacking Ceuta in 1415.
That, ladies and gentlemen, was a short clip of one of the Class 11 Notebook videos. Notebook has more than 10,000 such videos catering to every topic in every subject from Classes 1 to 12 available on the portal for your use. Well, with that, it is now time to move on to the panel that we have today and introduce our first speaker of the day. Our first speaker today is Mr. Philip Burrett. Mr. Burrett retired as the deputy headmaster from the illustrious Doon School in Dehradun after 44 years of serving in education. He served the Doon School as the housemaster, head of department, dean of student welfare, dean of activities, deputy headmaster, second master, and acting headmaster with great distinction. He also carried out a visioning exercise for the Doon School in the year 2011 through an in-depth study of a number of British public schools and various schools in the US. Mr. Burrett qualified as a leadership trainer at Wellington College, UK in the year 2000. He is also an athlete, an adventurer, and a naturalist. Sir, it is our privilege to have you with us. Over to you.
Thank you very much, Subhayu. I hope I'm audible.
Loud and clear, sir.
Yeah. Thank you so much. I like this topic, Beyond the Walls. So when I looked at it, I thought, I'll start with schools exist for more reasons than just simply, teaching academic courses and helping students pass examinations. Schools educate the whole person and seek to bring about a transformation in behavior, character, personality. The home and later schools are places where children are taught to respect rules and inculcate certain behaviors, which will make them worthy citizens of the future. Now, schools function by setting up a list of do's and don'ts, rewards and punishment, in order to lead students over a 6 to 8 year period from silly little pranksters to grown-up mature adults. So it is not too optimistic to expect that a good school should expect its students to behave responsibly even when they are out of schools, or even when they have passed out of schools, or shall I say, even during the pandemic. Now, schools are known by their present students, past students, and famous alumni. Also by their USPs, their moral ethical codes. Students are recognized outside school by their uniforms, crests, school ties, belts, and other paraphernalia. So a misdemeanor committed outside school by a group of students is easily traceable back to the school. And even now in this pandemic period, where students are not in uniform and may not be going around so much, they are still recognized by the towns they live in, the towns and the villages they live in. It's easily, these students can be traced back to the schools they belong to. Now, there are these school ratings done by Education World and other publications. These are perception surveys. These are surveys that tackle academic growth, infrastructure, alumni. Now, they also talk discipline. Now, these are perceptive surveys, and it just shows that the people outside the four walls of a school have a very clear perception, may not be 100% accurate, but they do have a perception of how students of a certain school behave. I was looking at the National Crimes Record Bureau. As many as 1,614 rape cases and 1,500 other sexual assaults were committed by juveniles in this country in 2017. Over 40,000 juveniles were caught across this country in 2017 for their alleged involvement in various offenses, with 72% of them in the age group 16 to 18. And the survey also discovered that most of these children who commit crimes do not go to schools. Now, we are here to exist. All of us exist within a framework of rules. None of us is above the law. There are traffic laws, laws of the club we belong to, rules pertaining to formal gatherings. Rules are usually made to make one's life easier and to safeguard others, like traffic rules, speed limits, no pets in swimming pools, because these activities infringe on the freedom and sentiments of others. Now, the best way of ensuring a student follows a rule, or for a rule to have a lasting impact and acceptability, is to explain to a student why this rule is applied. Or, better still, have the student involved with the adults in the school in the framing of these rules. They need to collaborate with the adults. Simply enforcing arbitrary laws and rules and making sure they're not broken is not an easy thing in today's world. Children also are very confused by a plethora of rules. There are home rules, school rules, rules of society, and the boundaries between these rules are often very blurred. Now, to ease the clutter between home rules and school rules, I mean, there should be a simplified system. Now, I know a school in Kenya. It's a round square school. They only have two rules. The first rule is, do not do anything that will bring dishonor to you, your school, and your family. And the second rule is, do not forget the first rule. It's a simple method. Now, obviously, universal rules such as honesty, integrity, not to hurt others, not to damage property or take things, they're no-brainers. Everyone knows these rules and will adhere to them. After all, which parent will have a problem with no cheating or no bullying? But rules regarding clothing, haircuts, length of skirts may not be that easy to implement, or they may be anachronistic and not in sync with the prevailing fashion. Now, there are rules which deal with superficial items like uniforms, wearing of jewelries and tattoos. But we fail to see that there are more important rules that we need our children to follow, even when they're out of school. Honesty, bullying, and harm to others. Now, I know a school in the States that I visited. It's around the Boston area. They have a very simple rule. We will not cheat, steal, and lie. There are just three things: cheating, stealing, and lying. And every student who comes to this school has to sign the golden book. I mean, these students may break other rules, but through life, the Groton School boasts of its children not stealing, lying, and cheating. Now, when school rules and home rules clash, then the problem comes. School rules often are the subgroups of rules of society. For example, the drinking age of 21, you know, and the school rules must be in sync with this. The problem occurs when parents and schools don't see eye to eye on certain rules. And this is when the parents defend their children and oppose the teachers and use their influence to protect the errant child from punishment. Now, I've seen parents who will sign on this dotted line and promise that they will adhere to school rules, only to slip in a cell phone or illegal money on their way out. This tacit connivance with their children is where things go wrong. And I think the biggest abdication in recent times has been the abdication of parental control over their children, because they tend to leave everything to the school. Now, to begin with, there could be different types of schools. Residential schools, where the housemaster is an in loco parentis and has much more control over a student than a day school class teacher may have. Boarding schools can and do enforce more rules than day schools, as the students are resident for about 9 months of the year. And thus the school authorities exert much more control and have much more responsibility. I also believe that boarding schools have a greater influence over a student's life than maybe a day school. In day school, students return home to parents each day, and then the home rules apply. These parents are equally and possibly more responsible for the student than the school is. For example, a boarding school and a day school may both have the rule of no breaking bounds, which means leaving the premises. But this may be more easily broken in a boarding school, where students may want to risk an adventure at night and see a movie. I don't think children in day schools would do that. Day school students are more likely to be involved in car accidents or to be seen at a late night pub, as these are more easily available to them. Now, if a student's alma mater has a powerful reputation built up over years through the efforts of thousands of past students and teachers, which the students will use to get into a college or a job, then I believe the student is duty bound to respect this reputation. Things cannot be one way. The quid pro quo must prevail. If the school shaped the student and gave the student a legacy that colleges recognize and job offers recognize, then the student in return must honor the school even long after he has left it. Reputations of school are built over decades, but shattered in days. Now, the jury is still out on the issue of whether a school rule applies to a student, even when the student is out of school or beyond the four walls. But many schools do impose the right of some control over students, even when they're out of school. It is all very well to be well behaved and wish teachers in the school, only to leave the school and work and act in most atrocious ways in town. Rules like not having long hair or piercing one's ears are those that need not be followed in the summer holiday vacations. But rules that are framed by the government, such as drinking age or driving age, they must be strictly followed by a student, even when they're out of school, and the school must ensure that they are doing this. How a student behaves and dresses when one is out of school, or what he does in a cafeteria, often is very important. Now, the older and more known a school is, the more dangerous the reputation of a school is at stake. Okay. Now, when I was at Doon, we were always suing the local newspapers, because if anything bad happened involving a student from any of the 10,000 schools in the area, the headlines always read, Doon school student crashes car, kills two, or Doon boy caught peddling drugs. And this was not the Doon school student. It was a student from somewhere in the Doon Valley. See, so the repetition of the school is very important. At Doon, we were very strict on rules being followed when students were outside the school, on town league. For example, uniforms had to be proper, no cell phones, no drinking, certain cafeterias were out of bounds, and a student could not drive a car even in the holidays, even if the parents had illicitly obtained a license. I have many times had to be called to town by parents and well-wishers because they had seen our boys badly dressed, shirts out of their pants, and I had to go and take action in town. Sometimes the railways also complained of poor behavior of our students on the way back by train. Now, we took action on this. Rules also apply to the use of internet and use of social media and abuse of social media. And often we checked Facebook accounts to see what the children had put out there. Now, these may be very draconic, but we had a reputation to protect. And the way I would explain to students who asked why I was being strict was, I told them that while I love the students, I also love the school. And I had to safeguard the school's reputation. Now, our schools, and I dare say many others, while it has had its share of illustrious alumni, we've also had our share of black sheep and students who have brought the school to disrepute. Students who have been rusticated from colleges abroad, had criminal charges against them, and also been in the news for the wrong reasons. All this reflects poorly on the institution. Often legacy schools have powerful old students' associations and lobbies, and a part of their job, I think, is to keep the old students constantly aware through the contact in sporting and social and fundraising activities. They must be aware of their duties to uphold the school's reputation. Now, the topic that I got from the notebook team had two words in it, walls and boundaries. And I'm often reminded of a poem by Robert Frost called Mending Wall. I hope some of you have read that lovely poem. And it talks about how we need to be careful of what we wall in and what we wall out. Too much walling in might lead to the stifling of a student's attitude and creativity. And too little walling in would lead to licentious behavior, you know. But enough walling leads to creativity and freedom to do what is best. Eventually, the proof of a good school is always the overall behavior and reputation of its students long after they have left school. I hope I have made my points clear. Over to you, Shubhayu.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you for that wonderful sharing of experiences that you've had with your students. I could not help but remember some instances from my own school days where we have met teachers outside the schools and we have either been called out for our tasks or we have been appreciated for what we have done. Schools exercise a phenomenal amount of influence over all of us, whether it's within the compound or out. Well, with that, ladies and gentlemen, it is now time to move on to the next speaker. Our next speaker today is Achin Bhattacharyya. Achin is the founder and CEO of Notebook. A chartered accountant by training, he was a director at Deloitte prior to starting Notebook. He has worked in India and abroad in various senior capacities in GE, PwC, KPMG, and Deloitte. Achin is an avid reader and a passionate traveler with a keen interest in economics, history, literature, and philosophy. He is a regular speaker at various forums and chambers of commerce and also contributes articles to numerous publications regularly. He is also on the board of some of the most renowned corporates and contributes significantly to their brand strategies. Achin, over to you.
Good evening, everyone. Shubhai, am I audible?
Yeah, loud and clear.
It gives me great pleasure to again welcome all of you to today's session on a topic which is becoming more important than ever with the increasing popularity of social and digital media. where any news, good or bad, travels at supersonic speed. As we all know, that it takes years to build a reputation, but just a fraction of a second to spoil it. One loose comment in camera, one, you know, irresponsible statement in any public platform, or any impulsive rash action can bring instant negative spotlight, not only on the person concerned, but also his family, friends, and alma mater. Thus, you can take a child from his or her school, but you can never take the school from him or her. A piece of it will always remain. In today's age, flow of information is real-time and democratic. And thus any news, and especially those which are of public interest, spreads like wildfire. This is more true for those youngsters who are standing at the threshold of adulthood and may be spending their final years in school. Thus, whether we like it or not, a school's reputation is inseparably and irreversibly linked to that of its students. Now, any notable good or bad action on their part will affect the school in a big way, which perhaps will have far greater impact than any other achievement or its propaganda. For instance, very recently, we were conducting our series of zero-hour debates, as many of you are aware. What we suddenly saw, and I'll not take names, neither of the student or of the school, what we suddenly saw, that a student started logging in from different IDs in those forums and started asking questions which were completely irrelevant with an objective of attracting attention. We could easily understand and track who the particular student was and from which school. But knowing the fact that he came from a very good school and the principal, I know him personally, is an excellent gentleman with a lot of integrity and values, I'm sure what he was doing was an irresponsible action which had nothing to do with his school. But then what happens is things like this definitely cast a very negative impression. However, before I move forward to deliberate on this any further, let me welcome all our esteemed panelists who are here today to encourage us with their thoughts and real life experiences on this topic. So we look forward to their enlightenment. Now, role of school. Schools leave a lifelong impression in a child's grooming process beyond their own domain of academic interactions. It's no wonder that parents feel an uncompromising need to deliver the best to their child in terms of good schooling. A good school brings forth the prospects of wholesome development in a child's grooming process. That does not merely supersede the classroom effect, but infiltrates into his or her personality, character building process, and values that his life stands upon. Noble institutions have traditionally practiced ways and methods to develop students and also work on student-teacher bonding that we all know is not limited to academic expectations. It is not uncommon to see a student develop behavioral traits similar to that of the institutional head or teachers who have closely groomed him in his formative years. Love for school becomes inherent among children who receive the love and affection from their teachers just as much they would receive from their parents. A natural love of association is built among students who continue to carry forward the values learnt at school to their home, their families, and the communities which they come from. and of course, into the functionality of their own lives. Thus, the impact of school is far greater. It not only impacts the student, but the entire community at large. Schools bear the ultimate responsibility of nurturing the cradle of the future generation. They are the center points that discover talent, instill values that many parents nowadays do not have time for. Schools build very basic traits such as empathy towards peers, spirit of healthy competition, and team building, the ability to share, care, and handling failures, and the success of enthusiasm as a single unit. Had it not been for the school, children may not have the chance to experience the same kind of togetherness and bonding that remains years after he or she has graduated from the school. We develop a sense of belonging. Now, this sense of belonging to me is very important. And why so? I'll come to it in my later part of my deliberation. But we develop a sense of belonging with incidents or moments that leave a lasting impression in our minds. And such deep impression is most often a result of what we have been ingrained with by our teachers during our school life. In the formative years of schooling that a child receives, schools build a faculty of thoughts, values inclusive of ambition, attitude, sportsmanship, courage, and positivity that constantly influences the individual's lifelong decisions, whether with regard to career, personal life, or behavior towards elders and other social and cultural behaviors. So, impact is huge. A good schooling can therefore be a turning point in a child's life. A good institution ideally throws up the best out of a student, and is believed that has been strongly demonstrated by most academic institutions that have excelled. Such institutions are not natural breeding grounds of great talent because of the class or strata of people they attract, but it's because of the innate culture of leadership and attitude towards life that they emanate among the students. It's a culture of excellence, working your way up, overcoming your own challenges that schools instill in students, that makes a mark of difference as the child progresses from school to other phases in life. Many examples of great institutions that have adapted to innovative modes of teaching exist in our country. For instance, Tagore's Shantiniketan is one where the noble poet believed in outdoor teaching beyond the classroom walls. Such modes of teaching have been thereafter adopted by many other schools, triumphantly proving themselves to be the bedrock of future leaders of the country, of eminent writers and social workers. Now, coming to sense of belonging, a sense of belonging in school is the degree to which students feel respected, accepted, and supported by teachers and peers. Burrett, sir, mentioned, I think, a very, very aptly mentioned about a school in Kenya. And he talked about only two roles. And the first one was the student had to ensure that they do not bring in dishonor to the school. Now, to ensure this, first and foremost, what is important is student has to feel connected to the school to a certain degree, so as to ensure that he values the honor of the school and treats it as his or her own honor. It has been linked to students' attention and efforts in class, their persistence and completion of learning activities. An understanding of belonging is important for educators. It allows them to plan effective practices to support students in the classroom and school-wide. According to international research, when students feel they are part of a school community, they will actively engage in academic and non-academic activities. Now, it's really important to engage, and to ensure that there is a sense of belonging, so that students really treat the school's prestige, honor, and respect as their own. Improving feelings of belonging in school can support both student engagement and achievement. Research shows students who report a higher sense of belonging in school generally put in more effort and are more motivated. A low sense of belonging is associated with negatives, possibly, you know, antisocial or delinquent behaviors. This could include misbehavior, drug and alcohol use at school, violence, and dropping out of school in extreme cases. Now, around the world, a lot of things are happening on this. So there's a research. In May 2018, the Australian Council for Educational Research released a report on Australian students' sense of belonging in school. It described as disturbing some of the differences in students' sense of belonging between male and female students, students from high and low socioeconomic backgrounds, and indigenous and non-indigenous backgrounds. While the majority of Australian students feel a sense of belonging at school, there's a solid core of students who do not feel this way, roughly 1 in 5, in any average classroom. The report analyzes the program for international students assessment, the PISA data, collected from 36 countries, including Australia. The assessment asks 15-year-old students to answer a number of questions regarding their sense of belonging in school. Prioritizing belonging within school culture is essential if done effectively. Educators can support students' emotional and social development and enhance their motivation, effort, and achievement throughout secondary school. Similarly, a study from the US found students' sense of belonging declines from year 7 through to year 11. With it, students' educational aspirations also decrease. Now, this decline may be due to a mismatch between secondary school students' need for autonomy and interaction and their learning environment. They may experience, at times, challenges with regard to teacher-student relationships, increased teacher control, and limited opportunities for autonomy. Likewise, I was going through some reports in Finland. Finland, as all of you are aware, is known for its innovative practices and policies with regard to education, especially the schooling system. Now, a study in Finland found students' sense of belonging weakened significantly, especially at the end of year 8. This might be because secondary students need to adapt to a larger social network and a larger number of teachers. So, they may not know their peers or teachers as well. Like vis-a-vis where they were in their junior classes, they had a smaller circle, deeper bonding. The moment, you know, you're in a senior class, you have your wider circle to interact with. So naturally, at times, they lose their focus. There have been similar findings in Australian secondary schools. Research in New South Wales found students' engagement in learning decreasing in middle or elementary or secondary school. This is referred to as the year 9 dip. So worldwide, this phenomenon has been referred to as year 9 dip. This dip is also present in students' reported sense of belonging. Now, I feel teachers are most important because when we discuss about a school, the culture, the ethos, it comes from teachers. Now, teachers play an important role in nurturing students' sense of belonging. If a student considers their teacher to be caring and accepting, they're more likely to adopt the academic and social values of their teachers. This can influence how students feel about schoolwork and how much or how little they value it. The teaching practices the teacher adopts in the classroom are key. Approaches to the teaching that foster belonging, for instance, include prioritizing high quality teacher-student relationship. Now, this is very important because at the end of the day, in order to bring a change, it is really important to train the trainer. It's all about the teacher, right? Creating a supportive and caring learning environment. Offering emotional support to students. Now, I guess this part is least spoken of, but undoubtedly very important. And being sensitive to students' needs and emotions. Another thing which I think is really important is showing interest in students. Trying to understand their point of view. See, all that any student expects is respectful and fair treatment, which I'm sure is being done. But what happens is at a particular age, during adolescence, at times, considering the fact that 100% complete maturity is not there, even good intentions and actions are misjudged. And likewise, there may be a disconnect from the student's perspective. Now, it's also important to give a voice to them, right? Fostering positive peer relationships and mutual respect among classmates to establish a sense of community and positive classroom management. Now, it's important to give students a voice. Their participation in extracurricular activities, developing a culture of high standards and behaviors across the whole school. Thus, if we are able to bring a sense of belonging, we can go miles in terms of students embracing the values and ethos of the institution and doing everything possible to keep the reputation and honor of the school at the highest level. Now, this is a vast topic. I think Burrett made a very, very valid point. The difference in terms of the way, you know, this topic can be approached for boarding school students and day school students. It's really important. Likewise, another very important aspect is the role of parents. We are discussing about code of conduct. We're discussing about what the schools can do best, of course, but I'm sure schools are already doing a great job at it. Personally, having visited so many schools and having interacted with principals and senior teachers, I can say this with great conviction. The schools are really taking care in this aspect. Also, parents have a huge role with regard to this. So, with regard to these aspects, and to hear more with regard to real life experiences, etc., I would now hand this over to Shubhayu and look forward to hearing from our stellar panel that we have today. Thank you. Take care. Over to you, Shubhayu.
Thank you, Achin. Thank you for that wonderful deliberation and a detailed expose on the topic that we have at hand today. But this is when, ladies and gentlemen, I introduce you to our guest speakers. As I said, we have a stellar panel with us today, so I won't keep them from you any longer. The first speaker we have today, ladies and gentlemen, is Ms. Hema Surapaneni. Hema ma'am is the ex-principal of an international school in Hyderabad. She has had a diversified experience in the field of education for the past 3 decades in teaching and training the teachers in the CBSE, Cambridge, and IB curricula. She has done her leadership program from the College of Education, Iowa, US. She worked as the principal for many years in various prestigious schools in Hyderabad, and she was awarded as among the 100 highly effective principals in India and the best leadership in education and management by the Progressive Academic Excellence Telangana. And she has been listed in the top 25 women leaders in Indian education sector in 2018. Ma'am, it's a privilege to have you with us today. Over to you. Ma'am, are you there?
Yes.
Yes, ma'am. Over to you.
Am I audible, Shubhayu?
Yes, ma'am. I can hear you loud and clear.
Yeah. Thank you so much. Very good evening to everybody on this platform. So it was nice listening to the early speakers, and there's so much of take home that I have received at this point. But I would like to ponder upon one very important aspect. I just want to give a different perspective, because I have my whole of my experiences from the South India. And I've been in the South, and South we see that there's a lot of involvement, parental involvement in our teaching ecosystem. So with this particular experience, I would like to bring in a different viewpoint here. And I would like to emphasize more on nurture and nature. So every child is born with certain innate traits. But when it comes to nurture, it is the responsibility of the parents to nurture these traits by giving them a lovely, positive, productive environment. I take this particular thing to say that Matru Pitru Krutabhyaso Gunitameti Balakaha Na Garbhachyuti Matrena Putro Bhavati Pandita, which means that a child just being born is not learnt, but he actually is nurtured by the mother and father to ensure that he actually shaped up into a beautiful individual. And he is the reflection of his both parents and also the family. Here, if school is considered the first phase of learning, then the parents are the first teachers who actually provide the blueprint, I would say, with a lot of ethics, morals, and values that actually help in sound character and personality building of this particular child. And later, when the child moves on to the school, the teachers actually have to kind of take in the same guidelines or the blueprint and help the child in mentoring, grooming, guiding him, and shaping into a beautiful, complete, I would say, a lovely individual, which actually can represent as a school ambassador. So in the preparation of getting to be a school ambassador, so the school has certain responsibilities and the parents also have certain responsibilities, which I would be throwing a little light on. Now, the school ambassador has a complete knowledge of the school philosophy, the policies, the standard operating procedures, the structure, the framework, and in running of the school. He carries the image of the school and the family with a lot of prestige on his shoulders, with a lot of responsibility and integrity. He actually has to work with the diversified groups of people with a lot of emotional quotient, interpersonal skills, enthusiasm, empathy, and compassion. He has to be a good listener. At the same time, he should be a problem solver, very outgoing. He should respond and react to others' needs. His communication skills should be excellent. Organization skills and time management skills should be perfect. And next, it's about the balance. He has to strike a balance between his academics and also the leadership activities that he's going to take it up in the school. So it is very, very important that we teachers and the parents have to come together in grooming such traits so that we can prepare him to be a school ambassador. And here, these traits are not short, short-term traits. It has to become a habit, and slowly his nature and second nature, it's not like a coat where you wear values and take it off. It has to be his nature. And this is just not pertaining to the family or school. It has to continue as long as he's taking up further higher education or the place of work in future, wherever. So he has to be the same until he reaches his grave. So the school has to have a philosophy wherein they're designing a lot of programs so that the opportunities can be given to these young learners where the traits, the innate qualities that actually have been nurtured by the parents actually surface to the top, and these traits can be exhibited. The qualities, the particular values or ethics given by the parents, school is the place where he can actually practice or express. So it's important for the school to design such programs or design such events and celebrations wherein the child has an opportunity to exhibit this. Especially the value-based value-based programs have to be designed by the school. Per se, it is about a respect day. Suppose you're having a respect day, it is about respecting every individual on campus, every profession on campus, be it a security to IMRs or the drivers or a plumber, electricians, scavengers. It is about appreciating their efforts and respecting the profession wherein the child actually understands how every profession puts in their best and he respects. It's just not about profession, respecting the resources like water, the library, then energy, power, whatever, food. And so he has to start respecting the resources that are available to him as well. And super learning day. Super learning day is when a child goes out to a stranger. It could be his senior, junior, unknown person, or he has never spoken to the person during his school time. And he goes to the person and learns something new and in turn exchanges knowledge. So this kind of exchange of knowledge is very good to understand, and that outgoing nature is enhanced. And coming to the culture capital day, where the student, teachers, even the parent community joins hands in bringing all kinds of cultures onto the ground. The school is a campus, on school campus, and they just celebrate it together. And with a lot of open-mindedness, they respect each other's cultures. So this is very important, something like Oracy Day. Oracy Day, where the communication skills, the public speaking skills, and also the oratory skills of the student can be enhanced, because he is going to be the school ambassador. It's very important for his communication and expression. So, and the social media day, wherein a lot of awareness can be brought in by the seniors to the juniors. And then there is a lot of debating that can happen on what is the importance of social media and how do we protect ourselves, and about the cyber safety, and a lot of topics in and around can be brought in. So this is how the important days. Hand-holding day is another thing where a lot of empathy comes in. So we have to design this value-based programs to give more opportunities for the children to exhibit the positive traits that we teachers or we educators want in our children. And these desired characters is what we have to push them, push it forward. And we have to make sure they inculcate them even on the school campus. It's just not the family. So they have to go hand in hand. Here, the teachers now have to identify the students through these programs and their performances and see if these traits are matching to their expectations or the prerequisites of a school ambassador. And they have to identify and make a small team. And just identifying, making a small team is not enough. This is where the teacher's role comes in. The school's role comes in, where they have to train these students further for a period of 4 weeks or 8 weeks on aspects like confidence, on aspects like creativity, collaboration, and organization, along with a lot of focus on skills, attitude, and values. Imparting knowledge is important, but when it comes to the training, these are the aspects we have to concentrate in making of the school ambassador, who actually will take our image of the school and family a long way. So now when this particular school ambassador is well prepared, groomed, it is very, very important that from the school, the parents, as well as the teachers, that they join hands. They have to work like two bulls of a bullock cart in pulling this cart further, where the cart has a treasure, that is a school ambassador. So when this bullock cart is going ahead, and even if one bull, whether it is a home or a school, just gives up or takes a back step or gives up on the child, then the cart doesn't move. The school ambassador's the dream, or he cannot achieve anything further without the support of the family and the parents or the school and the teachers. So they have to go hand in hand. It's very, very important for the school ambassador to just move on and do his best to represent the school and also the family. Now, the role of both the parents and the students is very, very, I would say, it has become more profound and prominent during this pandemic. The teachers and the parents have to come together. The school and the family has to come together during this pandemic, because we have moved our brick and mortar classrooms into the virtual classrooms. The learning has shifted. There is a complete shift. So the school has to design and draft a lot of guidelines, virtual guidelines, so that the student doesn't step beyond that. It is like a Lakshman Rekha. This is very important for the cyber safety of our own children. We have to expose our children to the cyber hazards as to what has to be done, what guidelines have to be followed. It is very important. This is something very new for all of us, the teachers, the parents, and also the complete school and the family. So while doing this, the school has to take the responsibility of preparing the children to be the digital citizens, or we call them as digizens. And these digizens actually have to be taught a lot of netiquettes and the cyberspace, how to use the cyberspace. The social media is actually, you cannot say that, oh, it's you are kids and you cannot use it. Now, social media has become the main platform for learning, whether it's Twitter or Facebook or Instagram, Snapchat or YouTube. When it is inevitable and you have to use this as media, so it is better to be cautious because it's a necessary evil. So the guidelines should actually bring in certain awareness programs as well, along with the guidelines, wherein you are telling the students what is a professional content and what is a personal content, and to what extent you can use a personal content online and what extent you have to put up this professional content online, because we cannot ignore the potential risk. But once the content is put out there, it becomes permanent, it is searchable, it is accessible, it is copyable, and it is also global. So in spite of having a very secure account, all of us have secured account, in spite of that, we are actually exposed to a lot of risk here. So it is important that our children are having this kind of awareness. Now, even when the teachers are giving some content to the children in the form of homeworks or notes or the concept elaborations, you have to, or certain researches or inquiry, it's very important that you give guided inquiry, a specific link, so that the child is not lost on the internet highway, where he's not going around the unwanted, uncalled for spaces, and he's victimized to the cybercrime. So it is very important, from time to time, we have to take all these measures from the school front. When it comes to the parental role here, parental role also has increased during this pandemic, I would say. The gadgets that they're giving to the children, whether it's mobiles or iPads or PCs or systems, they have to be cleaned because they've been used by the adults earlier. They have to be cleaned before they hand it over to the children. And it is always very, very important to install the firewalls. Firewalls are very important. And there are a lot of softwares, child control softwares, where you have Casper's child care and then Custodio, the parental thing, not in family. So these are the softwares you can install where the parent has a kind of a control in just monitoring the web activities of the child. So apart from that, the counseling is the best. The parent has to sit next to the child and counsel and see what kind of activities he has been indulging in from through this online process. He has to talk, probably there's a log sheet wherein both the parent and the child is sitting together and entering the log sheet as to what he has done, and all his cyber activities can be put on paper. So it becomes more transparent, and the school can actually provide some collaborative spaces for students, teachers, and parents, where the communication can be very open and transparent and more safe. And it would be, it's a kind of a thing you can express anything on that particular space. It's a collaborative space. Edmodo is one thing that they can go for, which is actually very user-friendly as well, and safe for the schools and the parents, both family and the school, to take up such things. So when it comes to the cyber safety, it is again the responsibility of both the parents and the teachers to take it up and take care of their children. I would actually say that apart to school ambassadors, when it comes to the same school ambassadors, whether they're in school or after school or way beyond, when they get into their job profiles, they have to be the same. So they have to be imbibed, and these traits that they inculcate, or they inculcated by the parents and the school, they have to carry it forward for a very long time. So the school and the family has to join hands in just not making a school ambassador, but also they are socially, I think they're ethically and morally responsible to give a good product to the society and the community, a very caring, sensitive, sensible product to the society and community and a country as a whole. So it is the responsibility of both front, school and family, to do that. So they have to join hands and to give this good product. And with this, I would conclude. And I thank Shubhayu and Abhishek for giving me this opportunity to just speak my heart out. So be safe, and let's just wait for the good times to come by because this pandemic also shall pass. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, ma'am. It's been an absolute privilege listening to you talking about school ambassadors. During the zero-hour debate that Achin mentioned earlier on, we had the privilege of meeting a couple of your students. Yes. And let me assure you, as an outsider looking in, your student ambassadors are doing a phenomenal job of representing the values that your school and you embody. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you so much. It's an honor to listen about my students. Thank you so much, Subhashubhayu. Thank you.
Ma'am, the honor is all ours. Thank you so much. With that, ladies and gentlemen, it is now time to move on to the next speaker today. Our next speaker today is Mr. Samajeet Singh. Mr. Singh is the managing director of the Saigrace Academy International School from Dehradun. He is a veteran educationist with a rich experience in school administration. Sir has been highly innovative in adopting new technologies in teaching and a social worker as well. Saigrace Academy International School is a co-education English medium boarding school and the first CBSE international boarding school in Raipur, Dehradun. It was awarded as number one in Uttarakhand among India's top 20 day-come boarding schools. Sir, it is our privilege to have you with us. Over to you.
Hi, good evening, everyone. A very good topic has been given to me by the notebook, Beyond the Boundary Wall, the role of the school in a child's conduct beyond the school campus. I belong to an army family. My father was there in the army and I've done my schooling from last, I believe I've changed around 9 to 10 schools and throughout my schooling life. What I have gained, I could share that points. The first point is, it is always what we can learn by doing. We can't go by book to learn things. Now, what is happening in India, still whatever the debates have been there, Mr. Burrett and Ma'am Hema and Abhishek and all three panelists were there. They were very fantastic and they deliberated very well. What I would like to tell in India, it is still, we are still confined to the boundary walls because still we are onto the marks. We are still onto the grades. So unless and until our policy, which is there now, the new education policy, which is framed up, it comes up, it is very difficult to even think about how to go about the beyond the boundary walls. Schools in India or in any space, we are working here, we are giving our students a platform where they can exhibit their inherent talents. It is not only academics, it is co-curricular, it is so many other activities. The basically what all schools, as all my panelists have told, they are basically 5 Ds, which the students they are being inculcated with. One is dedication, discipline, devotion, determination, and discrimination. We all would like all students of our, even our own kids, to have all these 5D principles in their life. Actually, these principles, they make student a good citizen after all. And if a student becomes a good citizen, 70% of the problem is solved over any nation. After getting an education of class 12 or 10th or college, the student still is not educated. So, talking about boundary walls, we need to basically teach them what these 5 Ds are going to give them a thing. The child has to be very truthful. They have to be very selfless, working. And they should be having a principle of having help ever, hurt never, something of this kind of principle, one for all and all for one. These kind of principles have to be taught to the kids. Because unless they build the teamwork, they can't live in a society. Now our society requires a team effort. If the child is given how to, the child is taught how to be in a team effort and he can lead a team, it becomes very difficult for a child to come and outside the boundary wall of the school and again exhibit himself. The basic problem is we have a vision of thinking beyond the school boundary wall, but are we able to do the things right? change is always required. We have to be basically thinking out-of-box learning. Out-of-box learning cannot happen only because we think that out-of-box learning should happen. The framework of our education system has to be changed 360 degrees. We still lack skilled education because we are more focused on the grades, be it any school. I have studied in Hyderabad. I know MCET there. Hema ma'am must agree to it. The pressure what MCET students face in Hyderabad, you can't even imagine in North. So, if you really want your child or your student to think beyond the boundary wall of the school, you need to give them an atmosphere where the child can progress. And progress to a level where the child can even think, yes, this is what I can do and this is what... Because it is, if you take good examples of good leaders, you can't... Students these days start quoting, yes, he was a dropout, that's why he has become smart. He is a dropout or at this stage he became smart. It is not the question because he is a dropout. It is because he wanted to do it and he did it. He had a vision to do it. So you have to be a visionary. You have to have a vision. You have to have a dream if you want to success. And for those all dreams and success in your life, you have to follow this 5D principle what I have spoken earlier. Dedication, discipline, devotion, determination and discrimination. The minute the child or any student at any stage is meant to learn these 5Ds, I believe the role of the school and you can even, because these 5Ds are not inside the boundary wall. They basically take you outside the boundary wall. Because service has to be first to uplift the society. You have to have that willingness to serve. Unless you are willing, you as an individual, you inculcate in your student to serve. They cannot even think to work outside the boundary walls. A good student is not necessary. A good academic student is not necessary to be a good citizen. But an average student can be a good citizen. Why? Because he is able to think beyond the boundary wall and other than the academics. Our focus should be that the child should learn around the... should leave the focus of the book and he should basically go beyond learning. I met Mr. Burrett and I had learned how Doon School was working with the students there. And it is remarkable they're doing and learning things. I went to so many other schools in India. But unless you do and learn, it is very difficult to have your old students who tell them to think beyond the boundary walls. Because in India, everywhere you come to know, you need to basically excel into the marks. Grades. If you just go away with the grades and marks, you will be able to think beyond the boundary walls. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. Given that your wealth of experience across the country with various army schools, it's so wonderful to hear you talk about how you want to expand the students' horizons beyond the school boundary walls, beyond bookish knowledge. Thank you so much for sharing that with us. Well, ladies and gentlemen, with that, we now move on to our next speaker. It is my privilege to introduce to you Ms. Anita Paul. Ms. Paul is the principal of the Billabong High International School in Jabalpur. She was formerly the head of school for the Indus World School, Gurgaon, the senior vice principal of the APJ School International Wing, South Delhi, and vice principal of the Vidya Gyan School, which is the Shivnadar Foundation's philanthropy initiative. Prior to that, she has headed the Department of Humanities at GD Goenka World School, Gurgaon, and her career spans over 28 years. Where she has held teaching and administrative positions at Wellham Girls School, Dehradun, Woodstock International School, Mussoorie, and GMIS Bali, Indonesia. Ma'am, welcome back to Notebook. Thank you so much for being a judge at one of our zero-hour debates. It's a privilege to welcome you back.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for inviting me over to be part of this esteemed panel. As well as a big thank you to Abhishek for following it up with me. I'll be sharing a PowerPoint presentation and I'll be speaking through it. My perspective is slightly different on Beyond the Walls. I have actually done my presentation on the present situation of the COVID-19 situation, which every school is facing across the globe. So my viewpoint was going beyond the wall, teaching and how teaching has taken a change, how security parameters for schools have taken a change, how the whole dynamics for education, the learning process has taken a 360 degree turn. We are still experimenting with a lot of innovation. We are still experimenting with a lot of disciplinary criteria for online teaching for both the educators as well as for the students, as well as our most important stakeholder, our parents, because this is now become a magnanimous kind of a classroom setup where we don't only have the educator or the student. It's not the learning between the two learners and the two knowledge, sharing sources, the student and the teacher. It's also the parent involved now. And the parent being in the classroom, and the classroom shifted from the four walls and beyond the walls, gone into the actually the bedrooms and the drawing rooms and the sitting rooms of our students. It's a very difficult situation right now for everyone to adjust to, but everyone tremendously making efforts to adapt to these new changes. Overnight, it was expected by the educators and by the management that each one will take on a new role. They will be kind of on a different platform altogether from which they were, most of the schools, unfortunately, were not aware of how to adapt to these changes because they had never used flipped classes, they had never used technology. So for them, technology was something which was banned earlier, which was a taboo to be talked about and used in schools. Even in the mainstream schools, I have worked in one of the schools where mobile phones were kept at the reception at the beginning of the day, and we were not supposed to use it throughout the day. We had our own internal system of communication. But today, that same gadget, that same device has become one of the most important tools when we are doing our teaching. But how secure is that? What are the disciplines that have to be followed while using those devices? What are the, the flip side of it, the disadvantage of using these devices? Are they secured platforms? Are they secured from viruses? Are they secured from hackers? That's another security issue. So where initially we were all discussing about cameras on campus and, having a GPS system on the buses to monitor that the child has gone. So there was an RIFD card which would monitor the movement of the child from the school or from the home to the school, school to the home. Now this has become a different challenge altogether. It is a struggle for all the educators continuously from morning till afternoon to keep saying, please switch on your cameras, switch off your mics. It's just an ongoing process. Assessments, doing assessments online using tools that are available, Microsoft Forms, etc. How secure is that? Will this cut down on the academic honesty policy? Because how do you monitor whether they are being honest and they are using it with integrity or they are cheating? So these are parameters which I thought was going beyond the wall. And beyond the wall is a huge gambit of things where education is concerned, whether it is from the K-12 or from the higher education. I think so all of us are facing those challenges. I will try to run through this PowerPoint presentation and try to bring in a connect. If I can share my screen. Can you see that? Is it visible?
Yes, ma'am. We can see your screen.
All right. So I'll just run the slideshow.
Sure, ma'am.
So I have used a few things from notebook. I've taken the liberty to do that. So excuse me for that. All right. So the school values that we have been following, and I have been following this for quite some time, it's an acronym, the acronym is RUHI. RUHI is connected to your soul. So the core values of our school were taking risks, openness, ownership, honesty, and commitment to our stakeholders by doing innovative ways of teaching. And this actually is now come across as one of the most important aspects while teaching online. We are taking risks every day. We are being very open. We are very transparent because we cannot do otherwise. There will be a lot of question marks. There are actually a lot of question marks happening with parents questioning the how much is online teaching helping, or how much is the online teaching equivalent to a classroom teaching? So there's a lot of questions still very open to all of us, and we're still trying to answer them. Ownership. Our teachers have taken the ownership. They have gone beyond the textbook teaching. They're not using any textual, only the textual format of teaching. They're experimenting with different video apps. They're creating a lot of, videos where they've done voiceovers. They've used a lot of videos. They've used a lot of stills. And they're still experimenting with that. Honesty, that's a key value that I had spoken earlier also. How academic honesty is still held strong, that the children still realize that because they've been given the ownership, they do not misuse that ownership and come across as honest, as learners who will be good citizens, who will be committed citizens towards their growth. And we are committed as management, as heads of schools, and as our teachers, to innovate and bring in new practices to the classrooms, new methodologies, new pedagogies. We are trying to bring in how we can bring in with activities, which also the NEP is speaking a lot about, that activity-based, skill-based learning is now the new thing, the new normal. We'll have to adapt those kind of learning processes. So that was one. So this is the new, what I thought was new ways COVID-19 could change how we educate future generations. We are divided with two generations now. One is the Generation Z and one is the Alpha Generation. So the Generation Z is generally the kids from 18 to 25, 16, 17, 18 to 25, who are growing up, who are so used to WhatsApping and Facebook and Snapchat, etc., that if they don't get that technology freedom, they get into these two forms of FOBA and FOMO, which is, as you can see, fear of being alone and fear of missing out. They tend to get into different kinds of depressive moods. So depression is taking, mental health has become a major issue during the pandemic. The last few months have seen a lot of suicides, a lot of children getting affected. Why children? Even the adults we have been seeing in every kind of industry, whether it's the education industry or the manufacturing industries or the film industries also. So we're seeing a lot of mental health issues happening there. So one has to be very beyond the walls now, that connect, that one-to-one, that that connect that we had, that by patting a child, and by talking to him, by our facial gestures, by our body gestures, our body language spoke a lot. We used to connect with the children. So how much can we do during an online class to keep these children connected? And communication as one of the skills, 21st skills, has to be taken as one of the most important aspects right now. Communicate as much as to with all your stakeholders so that they are feeling connected, they're feeling that oneness, and they're feeling that we all are together in this journey together beyond the walls. This is also a generation which sees the power of working collaboratively, which is again a 21st century skill. They are now seeing there are biggest challenges happening. So some of them are creating, if you've seen, they've created stands, pump stands for hand sanitizers. They have they've even designed beautiful face masks. So they're trying to help. They're looking after the elderly because they know the elderly have a lot of, diseases. And these diseases can be really death, they can be very death threatening. So they have taken a role of being, taking control of the old elderly or their younger siblings in the house. So responsibility has come in, which is also another key skill, to be responsible. So that's one thing that has happened. The new generation, which I said was Alpha, which is the children of the millennials, as we call them. Now, they are already born with, selfies from the very beginning of their birth. And they're very used to, so they don't panic. We've seen a very beautiful example of one of our Velumites, Kareena Kapoor's son. He's, Taimur is one of the most loved child by the cameras, and he's also very camera okay with it. He's not too running away from it. This shows how these children are growing up, how these children are adapting to the technology which is around. Also, possibly when they grow up, when history will be written again and they will read it in their classrooms, they will come to know how much our frontline workers were working for us, who were the heroes actually. Teachers will play, educators will play a very important role as our heroes. So I think so they will also learn, and hopefully living in societies where they were not having a kind of family, the father and mother working, so they did not have the opportunity to spend time with them. This pandemic has given them that time, so maybe they will be able to nurture those time together, and will respect the values of a family, which was slowly going away with the nucleus family being a fashion in the new world. But I think so again, this pandemic has shown us how family values are very important, and that is where you get more values and you become a very humble and very empathetic person. New classrooms for the process of learning has become homes, as you can see in this picture. I have put in the devices there. So it could be the tabs, it could be the phones, it could be the laptops or the desktops. And as one of my colleagues has just said, that how safe are these? These are being used by the parents. They are surfing through different sites, which could be adult sites. And it's very easy. So if they get recorded on the device's memory. So if a child gets hold of it and it's not deleted and it's the memory is not clean, these children will be exposed to those kind of adult literature or maybe adult videos, which may leave a very different impact on them. So that is one issue where the parents become a very important aspect of security. So they need to see that their systems are secure. The systems that have been given have a lot of, firewalls to protect innocent human beings who are growing up to become much more aware leaders of tomorrow. So earlier, this was a norm in schools, unlocking technology to deliver education. Any exam we would put huge posters, whether it was IB or Cambridge or I presume even the CBSE and the other exams, that you do not allow any kind of cellular or electronic or any kind of gadgets inside. But if you're going to do assessments at home, you need these gadgets. So I think this is going to take a flip now. And we will need to take new responsibilities up. We need to be more aware of what technology can do. So it's not an evil. What we do is what we can do with it. We used to say too much of screen time, too much of misuse of data that is there. But let me tell you, if it is used properly, if there is a proper guidance to them, it is a huge resource. This is somewhere children can do their research, which is again, research is going to be a new aspect of our new NEP. It's already a part of your IB curriculum and the Cambridge curriculum. But this will again bring in a lot of, usefulness, a lot of happiness, a lot of information. It'll open up the globe to the child who is accessing this data on the on the computers. So if it's used properly, definitely it is a golden opportunity for everyone. Cyber security has taken, as I earlier also said, the role of our security cameras at school. There are hackers around. Even in Zoom, sometimes there are some crashes. You will have people bombing into your Zoom sessions. Even Microsoft sometimes crashes because it cannot take too much of data into it. So there are still work which is required by these huge companies to get to it and create security parameters. So this is one issue which is very important. This, as I always said, is the parental control has become one of the most important role in today's time when online classes are happening. Classes have gone beyond your classrooms. Teachers did have a control. They could discipline a classroom inside the walls, but outside the walls, it's too far from the, there are 10 students from different locations on that Zoom session, or maybe 20 or maybe 30. How does a teacher manage that? So there is where the parent comes in as a most important, part of the collaborative part of helping out doing a little bit of monitoring there at the home. So parents become very important. new classrooms. Once the school opens up, all schools are planning out to do how to take it forward. Boarding schools are having different issues. Earlier school systems in boarding schools had dormitories. Now they have to plan out how to space out for social distancing, how the common bathrooms or the toilets, how to make sure that there is a certain distance maintained between the students. So that's their issue. Classrooms in day schools would be another issue. Will it be a full strength? Will it be just part half strength coming to the classroom or not coming to the classroom? How well the teacher would be doing blended classes? What would be the norm, odds and even? Maybe odds, one part of the class comes in and the other on the even. But the teacher has to then, how she will structure her, her learning outcomes, her learning objectives. That becomes a very important part there in deciding your lesson plans. So the two important changes that we've been seeing now, and it's also seen as a major role in the NEP, are the teaching of the life skills or the real life skills and redefining the role of the educator. Now, educator has to take a different mantle altogether. He has to reprocess the learning processes. They have to unlearn certain traditional, closed room teaching to an open, going out, doing more of, research-oriented learning, activity-based learning, problem-based learning, project-based learning. So all that has to be now incorporated full-fledgedly in our curriculum. So that rehashing of the curriculums will have to happen because now you will not have the children sitting inside the classrooms for some time till you don't have some kind of a crack on the medications or maybe the injections for COVID. So till that time, we have to restructure our teaching methodologies also. So redefining the role of educator becomes very important. Now the teacher has to be very, very emotionally strong. Not to snap is the easiest that a teacher can do when she's not able to reach out to her students because she's not able to see them, physically inside her classroom. So she has to manage control. So a lot of meditation has to come in. A lot of empathy has to come in. Her speaking skills have to be very, clear, very reaching out so that the student who's on the other side is understanding. So the communication skills have to be good. Time management plays a very important role because here you have a class and you don't have a time to move out from a classroom and go to the other classroom. There's already another teacher waiting in another channel to take up the class. So time management is very important. Flexibility is to be very, because there is differential level of learning. You have children from, backgrounds who are not able to cope up with the normal level of your speaking of 30 minutes or 20 minutes. You need to give them that extra care. So how is that going to be structured? So the educator has to now keep on redefining her role or his role and restructuring the way they're going to be taking forward their lessons. I have two short videos which I would like to play. So there you go.
Ma'am, when you
share... Sorry, Abhishek, I'll take that.
Yes.
Ma'am, sorry, just one word of advice. Because you're sharing your screen, we are not getting your audio.
No, I did not say anything. Sorry.
No, ma'am, not your audio, the video audio.
Okay.
If I may help you out, ma'am. Yes. If you could stop your share once.
Okay.
Start the screen share again. This time there's a small checkbox at the bottom saying share my computer audio.
It says share screen. So first I click that and then yes.
Okay. Ma'am, you can choose
I'll play
screen.
It again. I'll play it again. Yes, I'll play it again. Thank you for showing that.
No worries, ma'am. Thank you.
And I'm tired. A kid looked at me and said, teachers always say they're tired.
Yes, ma'am, perfect.
Yep. Grading 160 papers within a week is tiring. Composing and giving an original 20-minute long memorized speech in front of 30 people 6 times a day, every day, 180 days out of the year is very tiring. Especially when your speech is competing with iPhones, laptops, and Minecraft. It's tiring when parents tell you how to do your job. Or having to hold your bladder for an hour is tiring. Stopping bullying is tiring. So is feeling like you have to bring your best energy to work every single day. Or feeling like politicians think you're a waste of resources. And the media thinks you're a glorified babysitter. Cleaning up finger paint, glitter, and vomit is tiring. Teaching discipline to 12-year-old boys is tiring. Parent-teacher conferences are tiring. It's tiring seeing kids come to your class hungry and tired themselves. Reporting abuse is tiring. Teaching grammar to a generation of texters and tweeters is tiring. So is prepping kids for tests that will decide their future. Renewing your license every few years so you can keep your job is tiring. The month of May is tiring. So is being trusted to help shape the future of hundreds of young people. Chaperoning dances, coaching soccer, professional development, writing lesson plans, 20-minute lunches, standing up all day, being stern, being goofy, being a teacher is tiring. But when a student shows you their first college acceptance letter, or reads for the first time, or realizes the immense power of their words, or stands up to a bully in the hallway, or sits with a lonely kid at lunch, or geeks out about the ending of a novel, or bursts through the door of your classroom one morning to tell you that they finally know what they want to do with their life, or can finally solve this equation, or starts believing in themselves for the very first time right before your eyes, or returns to your class years later to thank you. Being tired is worth it.
So this was one video where I wanted to show the plight of the teachers and how the teachers are, you know, trying to struggle with little things, but the joy of seeing that the children are achieving certain things, even when the IB graduations happened and even the Cambridge, when the results came out, we could not have the, you know, official ceremonies of giving those certificates out. It was a very heartbreaking situation for all the teachers. But when students come back to us and tell us that, you know, they missed us and they missed this opportunity, and when things become okay, they want to come back to us and they want to redo this whole thing. It's really a blessing. So any disheartenment or any kind of depression that as an educator one feels just goes out of the window. I have another small video to share, so I'll just quickly share that and I'll end my session there.
The headlines say that school has been canceled. They're shut down until this crisis has been dismantled. Social distance measures have been dropped like an anvil. And since you can't guarantee every kid has a laptop, paper, and pencil, classrooms are empty, parents are extra busy, and our students are going crazy because school has been canceled. Well, except for the one where that teacher dresses up and reads books to his third grader. Well, and those that are sending personalized letters to their students in weekly mailers, and the ones making signs and celebrating high school seniors, making sure that they can finish their education and don't feel like failures. teachers. Well, and then there's those schools that are providing food for every kid in their area. Teachers and administrators bringing stability in all of this hysteria. Like holding Zoom meetings and greeting every kid by name before they share. Whose primary mission right now is to make sure every kid knows that they care. Who realize that this type of school isn't the same that it was before. It's not defined by learning content and getting a high score, but the motivation is creativity and finding new ways to engage students more. Like hands-on activities and encouraging them to get outside more. It's still caring for students who no longer walk through the door like the teachers who are delivering students' work from the trunk of their cars and are making time for virtual parent meetings from afar. Or how about the music teachers giving their students lessons online, having their students combine their music together on Skype, or those math teachers who are drawing problems on sidewalks in chalk for their students to answer when they go out for a walk, or the science teacher who's using school's 3D printers to protect law enforcement when they cough. Or my daughter's preschool teacher who called my little girl this morning just to talk. Or all those teachers who continue to be a rock for their students. Don't tell me that school has been canceled. School is not a building or a location. It's a collection of people who are committed to meaningful relations. And that's something that doesn't just dissipate when there's a virus that spreads across nations. Of course, it looks different, and there's plenty of resistance. But not getting together physically doesn't mean relational distance. We are being reminded right now of an educator's persistence and the vital role that they play in our society's existence. And they keep striving to provide our children with assistance. And now, when this is all over, we probably won't miss this, but right now we focus on what's most important. So let's be loud and clear in case the media does not report it. School is not canceled.
So this is what I wanted to end at, that school is not, as he said, only the walls in which we run our different classes, but it's the life that we connect and the relations that we create amongst every individual is what counts the most. So in the 21st century skills of all the C's, the 22nd century skill now definitely depends on relationships, on connectivity, on empathy, and on emotions. And I'll end my session on that. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Pam. This has been an absolute privilege. Thank you for sharing those wonderful videos with us. One of them actually reminded me of Taylor Mali's piece, What Does a Teacher Make? Thank you so much for those.
You're welcome.
I said, the schools have really expanded their borders beyond the boundaries, and it was such a wonderful, different take on the topic that we had for today. A special thank you from the design team here. Every week, we have some fun trying to figure out new looks to give our presentations and the invitations that we send out. And to see some of those elements make their way into your presentation, they are very heartened. A big thank you from them.
Thank you.
Well, with that, ladies and gentlemen, we have come to the end of the speaking sessions. Thank you so much for being with us. I will now invite Achin back for the vote of thanks. Achin, if I may hand it over to you.
Sure, Shivayu. I think great session we had today. Burrett, sir, I was listening to you very carefully. And I could understand how passionate and connected you are with the topic. Some great incidents, like suing newspapers to going to town to discipline a student whose shirt is not properly tucked in, acting on complaints from railways, or keeping cafes out of bounds, some cafes out of bounds, or not letting your students drive even during holidays. Now, this really shows your dedication. Your students were very, very lucky. That's the way I'll put it. And perhaps this is what really makes Doon aspirational. And I also liked your example of the Kenyan school. I think very well summed up just two values, not to dishonor and not to disobey the first rule. Also, what you mentioned about boarding schools is very true. I think in boarding schools, teachers have an even bigger role, because normally in a day school, naturally some part of the responsibility is also handled by the parent. In case of boarding schools, considering the fact that students are spending the entire day at the school apart from vacations, naturally teachers need to step in and their role increases. But I think great deliberation and some of the takeaways from your session, given your vast wealth of experience, are inspirational. And I'm sure our audience gains a lot from it. Ms. Hema Surapaneni, I think some very pertinent points you mentioned, parents' role, and the way you summed up about school ambassador and each and every aspect, whether that be respect day or super learning day, culture capital day, oratory day, social media day, handholding day. So I was listening very carefully, but I really found the whole thing very objective and crisp. And yes, preparing students to be digitans and teaching them netiquettes. I guess that is a very important need of the hour. Because we really can't lose a child in the internet highway. Mr. Samajeet Singh, thanks for highlighting the practical challenges. These are real-life practical challenges that you highlighted, no doubt about it. And also, great to hear about your 5D principles. I think these 5D principles, as you rightly mentioned, encompasses each and every aspect of life, both within the school and a much larger outside world. So I think very aptly put. Miss Anita Paul, first of all, thank you for your creative interpretation and highlighting the role of parents. So each and every aspect that you mentioned was really important. Securing our digital devices against virus, hackers, assessment tools. And I think I really like the concept of Ruhi. Great to know about your core values. And yes, as we deal with Generation Z, FOBA and FOMO are indeed important. I think role of parents in collaboration, when you are deliberating on this particular aspect, one thing that first of all came to my mind, which I really liked, is your fantastic sense of ownership. Considering the fact that during pandemic, the students are away, confined to their homes for a long time. And the kind of empathy, the kind of sensitive approach that you showcased and very clearly articulated your expectation from parents speak volumes about your sense of ownership. Yes, indeed, parents have a much larger role to ensure that kids, that students who are using the devices, etc., are digitally secure. Social distancing in boarding schools going forward, I think, is a very important aspect, which I'm sure a lot of our esteemed delegates today in the session, who are at the helm of affairs in different education institutions, I'm sure they're already working on it, putting their thoughts into place. And redefining the role of educator is the need of the hour. And as you rightly mentioned, ma'am, unlearning. Unlearning, history has proved time and again that unlearning is as important, if not more, than learning. Thus, being emotionally strong, flexible, is the need of the hour. And really, thanks for sharing the video. Very relevant and inspirational. And I think in the video, very rightly mentioned that schools are indeed have not been cancelled. As we have been seeing during last few months, schools are closed, but schooling is on. The kind of fantastic effort that we have seen on the part of schools and teachers to step up to the challenge, to embrace technology, and to ensure that education is not hampered, hats off to it. During the course of my interaction with people, with educators, academicians across the world, I can say this with great conviction that around the world, people look at India's schooling system with a lot of respect. And I think the entire credit for that goes to esteemed educators like you and like all our attendees that we have in the session today. So I think great session and some fantastic takeaways, some very nice aspects deliberated on. With this, we sign off for the evening and look forward to see you in our next Together for Education webinars. Thank you, take care, and goodbye.
Thank you, Subhayu.